Hey Hope Factory, hey Salem, I am here today with the most incredible, most beautiful Pastor Leslie, our children's pastor at Salem Baptist Church of Chicago. And she is going to help me continue our series, Difficult Conversations. And this time we're switching up the topic. We've talked about race and religion. We talked about what's going on around in the social political field, but this time we're zoning in. And we're going to talk about our sexual identity. Yes, we are talking about sex. S-E-X. No, sexual identity. Pastor Leslie, how are you doing? How are you doing?
Thank you so much, Pastor John. I love the Hope Factory. I'm so excited to be with you all virtually. I am well, just trying to stay warm in these cold Chicago streets.
Absolutely, absolutely. You look warm, which look warm and modest and holy. You're not on the internet, you know, in a bikini or nothing. You are just perfectly, just the perfect picture of wholesomeness and beauty and elegance. Man, you're a girl, I'm a guy. What does that mean? What is a sexual identity? I don't even want to go too deep into trying to introduce it, because I just want to hear from you. What's your perspective? Since you work with our kids when they're just discovering puberty, they're just learning who they are, they're just discovering that their body works differently. What is it?
Yeah, you know, my limited understanding, this is such a progressive subject, but my limited understanding is categories that are provided for our attractions, for our questions. And so I think the biggest thing that comes to mind when we think about sexual identity is LGBTQA, and that is continuing to be added to, it feels like. And so it seems like we live in a society that is eager to want to identify within a sexual identification category, which, I mean, we're the same age. This was not a conversation that I was having in high school at all. We definitely knew. We had a few friends who identified as gay, but the conversation has definitely escalated within the last decade, I would say.
Okay, so you said something like LGBTQAI. So that's lesbian, bisexual, and we can say these things because this is youth church. This is Hope Factory, so we're a little more mature. Yeah. Lesbian, bisexual, gay, queer, trans. Okay, so we got most of the letters there, and like you said, they're continuing to expand, and these are orientations that people are looking to identify with. I've even heard something about, well, some people might be born a certain way, or maybe they have always felt a certain way, meaning that they have a sort of gender dysphoria about them, where they felt like they were another sex than what they were, or that people have just always felt differently, and so they begin to go on a discovery path of what they are born, what their identity is, their sexual identity, and their attraction to others, or who they say that they are. Does the Bible give some insight, some indication on what people who are just curious or they feel disconnected maybe from what the traditional norms or even the biblical norms may have said man or woman is?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, Pastor John, what I love about the Bible is it's just so juicy. Like, it does not hide or censor anybody's business. And so throughout scripture, you see God introducing Adam and Eve, a heterosexual monogamous relationship. And then you see the patriarchs quickly get that wrong. They turn into polygamy. Wow. They get multiple wives. They get a wife on the side. Then you see Solomon with 700 wives, 300 concubines. Make that make sense. Make it make sense. How do you do that? How? Like, I don't know. Maybe Solomon had, I don't know, a phone book. Or, I mean, I'm perplexed when I think about that. But then you see even in the book of Acts, a eunuch. Philip is sent to minister to a eunuch of Queen of Sheba. So what I love about the Bible and God is we should not shrink back from these conversations. And you see how culture informed people's sexuality and the choices that they chose. And so my understanding is that in Genesis 1, when God says, I'm going to make man and female in my image, that was a very radical and profound statement that changed the game for the rest of mankind, in the sense that God is saying, I have two categories, male and female, period. I have decided to make you in my image. And what does that mean? That means that there is inherent dignity in human beings. Before I get an education, before I get a job, before I'm famous or any of those things, I have value because God created me. I belong to him. And so when I approach this conversation of sexual identity, I tend to think of it in this way. We bring these things, whatever, however you identify, whether you're gay, straight, bi, all of those things, we bring those things in the light. I don't believe there's any reason to hide them. But scripture informs us on how we're supposed to view our bodies. Since we've been made by God, God tells us you belong to me. Your body belongs to me. You've been bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. And so it's not that we don't experience these urges. It's not that we don't experience these attractions. It's not that we're just, you know, untouched by those things. It's that, yeah, God knows. Yes, you know, this is what you're going to experience, but bring that to me, and I'm going to give you the power to surrender that to me. Very unpopular opinion. Our world tells us, if you feel it, go with it. If you feel the vibe, if you feel a connection, do what makes you happy. Scripture commands a different lifestyle for those, only for those who identify as Christian.
And for you, you are unmarried.
Yeah.
We won't get into your status, you know, we won't put your number out there or whatever. You know, now that you sort of gave what God's categories are, we sort of know which way you lean or not. But for you, what's just some personal tips that you have? I think you laid that out so beautifully. I loved how you gave the complexity of how humans interact and how they identify, and also with the indications you see from scripture about the categories that God definitely initiated, engineered humanity with. And I think that's, I mean, obviously you're a top tier theologian, only the best. But beyond that, what's just some tips you give to some of my young ladies, some of my young men from your own lifestyle, someone who isn't just married, sitting at home with kids, you know, the temptations may still be out there. In the sense of you have not settled down. What's just some tips you could give for them with their practice of walking in their sexual identity found in Christ?
Yeah, you know, I am single. I don't have any kids. You know, and this is something that when I reflect upon, you know, I hate when old people say this. I guess now I'm the old person saying this. But when I reflect upon my time in high school, one of the things that I wish was communicated to me in a more clear way was my value, right? A lot of times I think we talk about sexual identity and even remaining pure or trying to live a life holy by God. We put that within another person's value. So for instance, I remain pure so that when I get married, then I can be pure, you know? And to me, that framework is flawed. You don't remain pure. You don't abstain. You don't ask God for self-control because you're trying to get married or because, you know, of fear. You do that because you want to please God. So I don't know if I have any tips, Pastor John, but I guess what I'm trying to say is, this is an act of worship. You know, you look at Romans 12, 1 through 2, Paul explicitly uses the word body. Submit your body as a living sacrifice unto the Lord. And so we tend to think of worship as I lift my hands and I cry and I say hallelujah. But worship includes what we do with our bodies. And so as a single woman, you know, I'm 30 years old. I'm a single woman, you know, and all of the temptations. I'm not immune to those temptations. But at the end of the day, I have to say, what is this offering me? So am I going to surrender my body to something that is against God? Am I going to surrender my body to something that is not of God? And so I think I think what is helpful to think about is how valuable your body is. Even if you don't think your body is valuable, know that God thinks your body is valuable. God has said that your body is valuable. And with that comes the sacredness. So who do you allow to be around you? Who do you allow to be in a romantic relationship with? Because your body is sacred, because your spirit, your soul, you as a human being is sacred. I wish that would have been communicated me earlier on, because I think that changes the game. I'm not saving myself. I'm not trying to be holy so that this wonderful man can come along. That's not my intentions at all. I'm saving myself because I love Jesus. That's it, period. Whether a man come or not. And that's very countercultural to pop Christianity. So I don't know, that's a tip. I don't really have any tips. I just really have maybe different ways of thinking about your body and your sexuality, and trying to go against what culture says. I think that's one of the best things that happened to me in high school was I figured out through the youth pastors how to think critically about culture. So music for me is very, I'm very sensitive to certain music. And so I had to learn how to think critically about how that impacted my life of purity, honestly. Cool. And so I could go up. I will stop there, Pastor John.
Yeah.
I don't know how to answer your question.
Yeah, that was great. I wanted to hear from you personally. I wanted to hear how you saw those categories being displayed in scripture and how you wanted to lay that out theologically. I love how you're willing to share and be so open. I feel like we need to do a part two because I've introduced a lot of words that might need some delineation, like temptation, and we talked about saving yourself and all those things. I really want to talk through those things from your perspective and get that done. So let's try to do a part two too. Can we do that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, let's try that. Okay, and you gotta go back to an interview with Salem. I gotta get on with Pastor Sean. So we'll continue this too. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. I love y'all, Hope Factory. Okay. So good to be here.
Great.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.